Today I'm chatting with Victoria Carella. She is a master shaman who had been working with ayahuasca, but now exclusively focuses on ceremonies with cannabis. She's written a book called Journeys, which is a poetry book about an exploration of being. It's an exploration of consciousness. It is a journey, one insight into what it means to be a fully aware being. Journeys is truly a movement through time and space of an individual and her spectrum of consciousness, insight, and growth. The author shares her most intimate journeys for those who are willing to take the plunge into that great journey, all done through the elegance of poetry and of rhyme. Very interesting. Victoria, maybe you're a master shaman. Let's hear an Icarus.
Okay, so let's just go ahead and set the space. We're going to set the space in one of light and love and medicine and receptivity. So
Sure. Can
you hear the medicine bell? Can you hear the medicine?
Sure.
This is a 17th century Tibetan medicine singing bowl I have, which is really cool. If you think about it, 400 years of medicine
Sure. Are
ringing forth when you hear this. Brija, brija, re velvea, pura, pura medicina. Brija, brija, re velvea, pura, pura luz divina. Brija, brija, rebelbea, pura, pura sabaduria divina. Shine, shimmer, shine, pure, pure medicine. Shine, shimmer, shine, divine light. Shine, shimmer, shine, divine wisdom. Ha na 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 na, ha na 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 na. And now I'll call the head spirit of cannabis that I work with, Reina Maria. Yana, Yana, Reina Maria. Alto manta trongo, sita punta manta coco, chita, flossi tangi oloroso. Shungo sitoini, flowers to your heart. Reina Maria, vede, vede corazon, amor, amor, medicina. Green, green heart, love, medicine. Gentle healing, cleansing, loving medicine. Hi, na, 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 na. Hi, na, 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 na. And the other head spirit I work with, Papatua. And I'm using a shakapa, the traditional leaf rattle, used in the, well, where I train in the Peruvian Amazon by the shamans. As we do the medicine work. Yana, yana, papa tua, sitoini, alto manta tronco sita, punta manta coco chita, lo sitangi oloroso, senti vitoini, na 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 na, flowers to the mind, cielo, cielo, ayahuasca. Cielo, cielo, medicina, hand, 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 sangi choini, senti di toini. Ender sangi choini, shungo si toini. Ender sangi choini, todas, todas energias, cuerpo si toini. Tranquilito sentitito, no terbaci wangi choini. Ukushi kushi wairo wairo. Cuerpo si toini. So we're calling on Papa Tua to straighten the mind, straighten the heart, straighten all the energies in the body. Tranquil mind, no turbulence. Calm, calm body. So those are a couple of ikaros for you.
Really nice. Really nice. You can feel the energy coming off of that. It's really great.
Yeah.
I think one of the things I'm interested in, I've got some questions kind of which I want to ask you, but let's just start off at the very beginning. You know, my channel's called Ayahuasca Magic, but you started off doing a whole bunch of different medicines. You've got a poem in your book called Epitaph where you describe kind of your journey and some various experiences you had, how you get called to Peru, and eventually how you started doing cannabis shamanism. And just, you know, listening to your Ikaros there, I mean, I can really feel the energy and the authenticity from your song. And I'm wondering, where did you get the idea for cannabis shaman? Is that something typical in the Amazon, or is that something you came upon by yourself?
No. And I would say, first of all, that Ikaros are not just songs. They're actual, the medicine, sacred medicine, energies, medicine that you get from the medicinal plants, the teacher plants that you're working with. And through the use of sound and the vibration, the shaman shapes the space, shapes the geometry of the space, and holds the space. So it's more intense than just a song, just to clarify.
Oh, yeah,
that.
Yeah. One of my big things has been that, you know, I've had some really profound experiences through Ikaros. And a lot of people think this, that they're just songs, but my theory is they're kind of like they're information. They carry information. The melody carries information and spirit, or medicine, I guess, is what you call it, right?
Well, totally, because that's the communication between the shaman and the head spirits he works with. And I mention head spirits because shamanism itself is a dualistic practice, because you see, you work with spirits, and anytime you work with spirits, those are something that are separate from you. And that's what I mean by dualistic. So anything that a person identifies and labels as separate from themselves is a spirit. And you can conceive that there are many, 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 many spirits. So most shamans, myself included, work with the head spirits, who then direct other spirits to do the work. But again, that's the message, and that's the work of the medicine between the shaman and the medicine spirits, to guide the journey that the participants in the ceremony are in, and to shape that journey. And it's for the participants in the ceremony to focus on the Ikaros, not to get lost in their own head trip, because then why bother being with a shaman? The thing is, and it's easy to get, you know, when you're intensely into consciousness, to get lost in your own story. But the purpose is to really focus on the Ikaro and take the journey that the shaman is taking you on.
Was that part of your journey when you went to Peru? Obviously, these days, everybody's going to Peru. Lots of people are having like experiences of light or whatever, which are quite temporary. But was part of your journey, because you're talking about, like, I mean, a lot of people talk about meeting spirits, but meeting head spirits, that seems to me like it's something you need, like, shamanic help to really help you connect to that energy.
Yes, and the whole point of apprenticeship is to work with the teacher plants, and the teacher plants have their head spirits that you work with. And it's not only, you know, the drinking of ayahuasca, it's also the dietas you do, and working I worked with Sanango intensely. One of my favorite plant teachers is Abuelo Sanango. And then you do the teas, and you absorb all the spirits from the teacher's plants into you when you do these dietas, and they become part of your being, and they become part of your work that you have to do. And it is true. I was fortunate enough when I first went down to Peru that it was before the tourist trade heavily started in ayahuasca. And a lot of people, Westerners in particular, when they go to Peru or wherever, they may drink ayahuasca, and they drink maybe once or twice. They have these revelations, and then they think they're all of a sudden a shaman. And becoming a shaman involves a lot. There's many, many years, and it's an extreme process. And so one of the most important things I tell people about ayahuasca ceremonies or any type of ceremony you engage in is to the integration is the most important part.
Yeah.
What it's not just that experience is what you take with that experience and how you fully integrate it into your being. And cannabis was not used. I did not use it in South America. The reason I mainly turned to cannabis is because when I returned to the States, ayahuasca is not legal.
Yeah.
And the ayahuasca you get in the States from some places that may have it isn't really, I would say, the full intensity of the brews that are made in South America, because every head shaman down there has their how they mix the different plants and the strength of it. And a lot of those, I don't believe you can get in the United States. And it's just where the medicine was born and where it gave birth. And that's just different than when you, take that, the plant, and remove it from its traditional setting to a Western setting.
You bring up an interesting point that, the part, or maybe the biggest part of the shamanic journey, seems to be working with dietas and other plants. In a way, ayahuasca gets all the press. Everybody talks about ayahuasca because it's so luminous and so illuminated. But yeah, Actually working with these other dieta plants, whether it's sanango or chuchuwasu or ayayuma or whatever it might be, mm-hmm. I think a lot of the real power comes from, I'm just guessing because I'm not a shaman, but a lot of the real power seems to be coming from these other plants.
It's a combination. It's a full, when you're doing an apprenticeship, you take the full spectrum of working with the teacher plants, and that's just part of it. Ayahuasca by itself is one part, but it's not the whole part. No, sure. And all shamans are trained in learning all the different medicine teacher plants down there.
Yeah.
And so I came to use cannabis in the United States. The shaman I was working with also started the master shaman who was training me, because I finished my training in the States.
Yeah.
He also went to the use of cannabis, because when we were back in the States, you want to keep things legal. That's the way it is. And working with it, when cannabis is used as a sacred teacher plant that it has been for centuries before maybe Westerners got hold of it and turned it just to recreational drug, and it's used in ceremonial context, cannabis is an extremely powerful healing and transformational medicine plant. It is very strong, and I would put it up there just under ayahuasca as far as the strength of what you can, if you treat it properly, if you treat it with respect, the medicine teacher plant will reciprocate, you know. But it also, I would say, to be used with a shaman who is trained in the use of it, so you can really get the full benefit out of it in the ceremony. And it's a, I only do, like I said, like you mentioned, I only use cannabis, and I only use it in the United States where it's legal, either medically or recreationally. And again, it's just giving it true respect. In the Western culture, we have a tradition of taking like traditional medicines, you know, peyote or mescaline or ayahuasca or cannabis, and just like distilling it down to changing it, taking it out of its holistic content.
Sure.
Like taking DMT may be powerful and strong, but again, you're missing the holistic approach of the medicine plants and everything that's all the spirits and medicine spirits and teacher spirits that are part of that medicine. And so I think, and the same with cannabis, when it's turned to where it's not respected as the teacher plant it is, the teacher plant won't respect and won't reciprocate.
Can you take us through, like, everybody knows, I guess, who's done ayahuasca, kind of how a ceremony goes. You know, you take the medicine, you wait for 40 minutes, you start having visions. In a cannabis ceremony, like, how does the flow of the ceremony go? Are there distinct phases of the ceremony which are visionary or more thoughtful? Or does it change, like, from ceremony to ceremony?
Well, it's also interesting because you mentioned vision and visuals. And myself, I've found that vision and visuals are just that. They're just visions and visuals. They're nothing more and nothing less. The importance, the strength out of the ceremonies is to go, for me, was to go beyond the visuals and the visions and to go directly into consciousness, pre-consciousness, and the medicine. To me, I found the visuals distracting after a while. And I actually asked the medicine spirits to stop the visuals because I wanted to be able to really focus on the purpose and intent for me of ceremonies, which is to evolve and raise your consciousness.
Sure.
And the same with cannabis in ceremonial context, in mine anyway, are extremely strong, and the visions are there just as strong. I've had people in ceremony just totally blown away by the fact of the visuals, but then it's like I stress the fact is that's not the focus of where we're going on this journey. You know, it's just like use those visions and visuals as like wormholes to get through to the dimensions of consciousness that we're looking to investigate and to explore.
Sure.
And as far as the ceremonies, I start them with setting the space, just like with ayahuasca, and or with any ceremony, I would say, not just ayahuasca. You set the space. The shaman sets the space, and he holds that space, and he moves the geometry of the space. With each ikaro you sing, yep, you shift and move the geometry of the space. And again, you go on the journey of the exploration of consciousness. So it's...
Now, would you describe the, I've had this theory for a while that consciousness and imagination are kind of synonymous. Now, would you, when you are exploring consciousness, are you exploring this in your own mind when you're leading a ceremony? Are you taking like an imaginative journey? Are you following sort of symbolic clues which come up in your imagination as you journey down or up to wherever you might be traveling in consciousness? Or... how, if you're traveling through a space which we call consciousness, how do you make the journey? Is it with imagination?
First, I would say as long as you define the imagination as one not of a fabrication and fantasy,
sure,
okay? That's not what, when we talk about imagination, it's basically a gateway to the dimension of a consciousness.
Yeah.
And when we talk about traveling, I guess the way I view it is everything that you experience and perceive takes place in the mind. In the first place, that's where it is, and that everything that exists right now, I'm in your mind and you're in my mind. It's the mind is from here to infinite space. That's all inclusive, and the exploration of this, that again goes back to the ikaros, working with the head spirits, and as they communicate and the shaman takes that information, working with the intent of the participants of ceremony to take that journey to where people may not understand when they set the intent, they should release all expectations. And any type of ceremony or work with the medicine plants is to release the expectation of this is how I think it should turn out because this is my intent. Well, that's not how it works. You set your intent and the medicine spirits, the teacher plants, will work to fulfill that intent, but it may be in a completely different outcome than you ever would have expected. So you have to leave yourself open and receptive. You can't determine how this is supposed to be answered or met. So that's part of holding the space so it's a safe, secure place that people feel safe enough that they can just relax and open and receive the medicine and the work and not to try to self-direct it.
Yeah. So in but a of way, course, in a way, when you start traveling, you were saying that it all takes place within our minds. And I guess when the ceremony starts, it starts like we're all inside our own personal mind space. But as we progress with your Icaros, we start sharing the mind space, and then further beyond that too. Because I think one of the problems generally is a lot of people seem to talk that, you know, it's all within our mind, but there's a misunderstanding of what the mind is. The same way as with imagination. It's much bigger than is commonly thought about. Would you agree with that?
Well, you can speak of the universal mind.
Yeah.
If you want. I mean, if you look at where I've become working with the medicine as everything is one, the medicine, love, we're talking about the oneness, that everything is part of one, that there's not separation. When I say it's all in your mind, it's because all is one. Everything that is exists in your mind. I mean, because otherwise you can't experience it. And we can call it the universal mind, but I still say that every person is their own universe in that respect.
Yeah.
But we all, when you open up medicine, you open up to the flow of being, of love, of oneness, of universality. I mean, it's like some of my Icaros go to the fact that you are here, you are everywhere, you are nothing, you are everything, you are the point of singularity.
Yeah. When you learn the Icaros, I recently did a short dieta of Bob and Santa, and it started teaching me an Icaros, but it was mainly just like a melodic theme which it taught me, which was really beautiful for me and nice. But a lot of times, like when you just did your two Icaros there, you were switching out of Spanish, you did some English, you might have done some Quechua in there, I'm not sure. Does the medicine teach you that? Does it just come out as you're learning these Icaros?
Yeah, it's a direct communication. It's just direct communication and flow. And like you said, some is Cajun, some is Spanish, some is English. It's just how it's done. And when a lot of times I'll try to sing the English version of what I just said so people understand what's coming out. You can follow the flow. But it's not like I'm sitting around thinking about things. It just is.
Yeah, you know, there's another shaman in the States called Hamilton Souther, and you've probably heard of that guy. He gets quite a lot of press these days, but he does cannabis ceremonies too. And for a while, he was trying to do cannabis ceremonies online and trying to create a medicine space using the internet to try and connect people who maybe couldn't come to see him or whatever. So I tried doing it just to see what it was like. This was a couple of years ago, and it was quite interesting, but he also was switching into English for probably the same reason, to try and make it more understandable to the general people. Now, you've had quite a journey. Now, you did this, you've done this book, and like how long have you been working on the book? Because it represents quite a body of work there. There's about 160, 170 pages there, and there's quite a lot of content. A lot of it's quite personal, I think. A lot of it is talking about events that have happened in your life, and then also some of the journeys, some of the conflicts, and some of the challenges possibly that you've come up against. Because it's really easy now for you maybe to talk about, you know, I'm a master shaman, but I think getting to where you're at now may not have been a smooth journey. It probably had quite a lot of challenges. Is that fair to say?
Well, yes. I mean, I shouldn't imagine that it would be a smooth journey for anyone, because the process of becoming a shaman is you completely tear down your whole being. You tear down your psyche. You tear down your psyche, your consciousness. You go through physical death and rebirth. I mean, it's a process of then becoming replaced with your shaman body and being a medicine, well, I don't say woman, but a medicine person. I mean, there's nothing simple about it. I mean, and historically, it has never been that way. It's a trial by fire. It's a whole reorganization of your whole being, and it's, as far as the writing of the book, it's interesting. It just flowed. It's not like I sat down with a pen and paper and tried to chart out what things should, what how it should be and what should be, how they came out, how they're written in the book is how they flowed out of me in the writing. There was no real, you know, thinking process. It was completely a flow in front of the computer and just writing.
Okay.
And
so you weren't trying to like copy anybody's poetic style. It was just something that came naturally, and you were sort of almost channeling a sort of vibration which came through you to write out what was happening.
Oh, sure. I would never want to copy anybody else's style.
Sure.
I mean, that, what would be the purpose in that?
Yeah.
No, there was, it was just how it was, working with the, again, medicine spirits that, and head spirits and the flow of the, once, it's interesting, when you get in the flow and you know you're there and things just flow. I don't know how
sure.
to explain it, but and the other interesting thing, I don't know if you have a picture of the book to show people, the cover or anything like that.
Sure,
but, because the drawing on the cover is one of my shamanic medicine drawings. And it's based, if people know that, you know, Michelangelo's Sistine Chapel, where he has God and Adam, and they're both reaching out to each other, but they never touch. Well, in my interpretation is, as you can see from the picture, both hands are touching, and it's entitled No Separation from Divinity, because we are never separated. We only get lost in our own story of separation and illusion of separation, but in truth and reality, we are never separated, you know.
Yeah, that's really interesting to me. Just before we get into the book, there was something I wanted to ask you, which kind of ties into what you were just talking about how there's no separation and that we are connected, but there's an illusion of separation. Now, one thing that happens to some people, and it happened to me, that's why I started my channel, is I did ayahuasca for a couple of years, and I did quite a lot of shrieks and angle with a local shaman here in Chile. And what happened is, one day I was sitting in the garden meditating, and I started, this was about three months after my last ceremony, and I started seeing spirits in the garden without any medicines at all. And there seems to be, this happens with some people, I think, especially people who do, there's a couple of people on the Facebook group who've done a lot of DMT without shamanic intervention. And it's sometimes it's what happens. It seems to cross a line of, I guess the word is dissociative or psychotic. You get these sort of psychotic episodes where it becomes really visionary, but it's not controlled. And it's maybe that's part of what you're talking about here, is that there's an illusion that we are connected, but if we don't have a guide to lead us to understand that we're connected, maybe we can have these episodes which aren't really productive. Have you ever had any experiences with people where they've had this kind of, because, you know, I guess with as a shaman, you probably occasionally get people who push the boundaries of their abilities. Have you ever had any problems with clients or people coming to ceremonies and they've had problems like this, where they've pushed the boundaries a little too far, and maybe they've had sort of episodes which they thought seemed a little psychotic and they needed help? And can you help them if that happens?
Well, I'd say yes, and for sure. And I'd say a lot of that comes from when they don't have... One thing to know is our shamans are just like people. There's good shamans and bad shamans. And there's people that don't work with shamans, and they use medicine work on their own. And there's always a danger in that, because with either one, if you don't have the proper guidance, again, with sacred teacher medicine plants, we're talking about powerful, powerful energies and forces. And you need to learn to respect them. Mm-hmm. And that's why you have shamans, is to guide people and to hold a protective space so people can go through their experiences. And yes, I've run across people who have, in the States, have had problems because they either did some of these teacher plants on their own without any guidance, or the guidance they had was not particularly positive. And yes, you can help them, but it's a process, because you basically have to have them, you know, reintegrate themselves and release energies that may they have acquired through this use of, not a safe use of, these teacher plants. And one thing about especially dietas and ayahuasca is, I was mentioning it, integration is critical, and it's crucial to the use of these plants. And you will find that after ceremonies and after dietas, it can be 6 months up to a year that you will still be having these experiences with the teacher plants, because they're now part of you and they're working with you.
Yeah.
And if you, again, use them with respect, I think they'll respect you back, but you have to give yourself time to integrate them and let them settle in. But it's really critical that people have the right guidance when they use these plants. These plants have been around ever since humans have become humans. They have used certain teacher plants as part of becoming human, as part of becoming in raising of consciousness and working with spirits. I mean, you can go back to the very beginnings of humanity, and there's always been a shaman. There's always been that guiding force in the community, the healer, and the go-between the spirit world and people. So there's always these plants have played a critical part of that. And I always find it extremely interesting that there is this symbiotic relationship between teacher plants and humanity. It's wonderful, and it's awesome, and it's mind blowing to me.
Yeah.
And if you think, again, to give respect to these plants, because they give up their earthly life to be so that you can use them and to become part of you, and you have to respect that. I mean, this is a spirit that's doing that for you, and you in return respect them and treat them properly, and that you build a relationship to the medicine spirits you're working with. And like any other friend relationship, if you don't continue to build on them and keep them active, they die away, right?
Yeah.
And so even with the dietas that you use, you have all these millions of spirits that are now part of you that, you know, you talk to them and you work with them and you keep that active and alive. The people can really have problems if they don't treat these plants with respect.
Now, when I had that experience, it manifested as like various interactions and dreams and also in the real world, but with just like what I call it with like pure evil. It was real. It was frightening, frightening evil. Now, I noticed when I was reading your book, you've got a whole bunch of interesting poems where you talk about some of the challenges you come up with. Now, I noticed as I was reading your poem, Mainstay, there seems to be a point in Mainstay where you're having, where you confront something which seems to be, I don't know if it's evil, but it's something which is challenging, but you identify it, I think, like it might have been part of yourself. Is that what's going on? Is all the evil which we might come face to face with, is it actually part of ourselves? Or is it exterior?
Well, and it's interesting, the word of, you know, good and evil. And again, that's when we live in the dualistic world that we do. But when you transcend that and go to oneness, you'll find that everything is a manifestation of love. And it has no... And when you work with head medicine spirits, they don't define this as, oh, that's good or that's bad. This is just something you're working with, right?
Okay.
And most of... Yes, and most of what people, what you run into are projections of yourself. I mean, it's projections of what's inside, and you project it onto the outside world. And humans have a fantastic capacity to create such darkness. But we also have that wonderful capacity to balance it with light and love, because everything that we see and experience is a reflection of light.
Yeah,
everything. We're all photonic beings, and light is a spectrum. It's not divided into this and this and this. You have the whole spectrum from ultrasound to the other end of the spectrum, and in between there's a small section of visible light, but also radio waves and sound. It's all frequency. It's wavelengths, and it's photons. It's quantum medicine. We're quantum beings, and we're all, again, reflections of light. We're not reflections of darkness. Everything you see and experience is because light is being reflected off of it.
Yeah.
As far as, I mean, people is, you know, it's such a strong word. It's just, you know, if you work, let's say, something negative or positive, I mean, when people start putting a lot of thoughts and energy towards negative things, it can create this, you know, huge force. and it's, we as humans have a full capacity to be the true enlightened beings that we are.
Yeah. Now, you're speaking right now about this, and it sounds logical, well, almost obvious, but I'm imagining that wasn't, I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but I'm imagining that wasn't completely clear to you when you started off your journey. Like, I think maybe when you started...
Well, of course not, because if it was perfectly clear, I would never have gone on the journey in the first place.
Right? Because I'm reading, like, I was reading...
The process.
I was reading your poems, and you do talk about, like, the difficulties, like, you've had, and some of them started in this world, like you had some family issues, and then as you moved on, you know, you confront what you're calling now, like, projections of yourself, like things which challenged you. Can you talk more about it on, like, a personal level? Like, what happened? Or maybe read one of your poems so we can...
Well, I was born, for starters. That's right. How it all started. But, you know, the poems are a metaphor for just for life. And life is a process. And one of my favorite poems is Telltale, but it takes about 8 minutes to read. And I don't know if that's too long for you or your audience to listen to.
Do it. Let's do it.
Okay. It's called Telltale. Down a twisted lane, covered with vines, stands a solitary house, seemingly out of time. Quiet and brooding, inviting though, making one approach, cautious and slow. Up the front steps, onto the porch, opening the front door, lighting a torch. Holding the light up, looking around, nobody here to be found. Yet in the fireplace, the fire's lit. Seeing this down, you immediately sit. Seems the house was expecting you. Lighting of the torch was its cue. You turn your head, wondering if you should leave instead. And open still is the door. But you decide to stay for a little more. Somehow you know you must walk through this place. There's something here you must face. Staring into the fire, you begin to tire. You lean back in the chair, one of the finest quality, really quite rare. Your mind immediately begins to roam through this house you for some reason think of as home. You are wondering why you would do that when out of nowhere appears on your lap a cat. This seems rather strange indeed, especially when it asks, "What is your need?" But you state, "I never called for you." "I know," says the cat, "few ever do. And before more you see, you have to pass by me." Well, that doesn't seem quite fair. Perhaps, I don't really care. Those are the rules. Use them, they're your tools. So how did you gain such an important position? Why are you the one I must petition? Well, often the feline is guarded the gate. But enough of this, ask or you will be too late. Too late for what, you ask? To be getting along to your next task. And I see you have come a little unprepared, no matter strong will you have shown by how you've dared. But mind is only one of the three. You still have soul and spirit to prove to me. By your questions you have shown your need. It's best you move along with the greatest of speed. And you begin to ask where, when you notice the cat is no longer there. Instead, a short note. The room to the right, after you remove your coat. So you hang your coat on a rack and move along, hoping you're on the right track. Into the room you enter, wondering where is your mentor? The room is rather small, pictures lining all four walls. Up to one you go, looking it over very slow. And there is Freud looking back, in one hand holding a sack, staring right at you, as if you he personally knew. Uncomfortable you undoubtedly feel when the picture speaks. You have a problem with which to deal? Not I, you state formally. I always act rather normally. This you say as you begin to jump up and down, playing the part of a foolish clown. No, this is not me. I'm afraid it is, you see. Suddenly a member of the opposite sex appears, and you are overcome by a flood of fears. The person's face begins to go through phases. So many questions and doubts this raises. Phantom images of fathers and mothers, melting into those of sisters and brothers. Next into past friends and lovers it changes. Thoughts about yourself this definitely rearranges. Finally at yourself you look, scanning a small book. Discovery of your sexual self, it reads. Answer to these questions we all need. Why certain ways we act, why some people we attract, why by some others we are not satisfied, why with others we never even tried. But this book does not all your needs meet. The answers are just a little too neat. You know it's only part of the whole, affecting only some of your roles. So into Freud's sack you put the book. Thank you anyway, but somewhere else I think I'll look. Well, make sure you don't slip and have an interesting trip. You move along the row, not having very far to go. Upon a picture of young you come. Looks like the type that could help you some. Hello, you say. I have some questions before you I'd like to lay. The picture states, give me a dream, regardless of how trivial it seems. Why, I don't remember any offhand. My, that's rather bland. Come back when you have one. Well, that leaves you a little numb. Will a symbol do? Of these I have a few. Speak. Don't be so meek. Give me a chance. Then around you begin to prance. You take out a crown and put it on your head. Then it decides it belongs on your feet instead. Ah, an interesting show. Obviously you are your own main foe. So you pick the crown up. It turns into a cup. Drink from it you do, offering some to the picture too. Drinking, young says, time to pass on. Beyond me, you have gone. Turning, you see the cat on a mantle. Well, that you certainly handled. Yes, I feel good. And rightly you should. Suddenly you decide to turn around and proceed to take all the pictures down, filing them in a pile so neat, then crushing them to dust with your feet. The dust you sweep up with a broom, then address the cat, on to the next room. My business here is complete, and I am ready for another treat. A little hastily you act, that you are done in this room is not quite a fact. Remember your pile of dust is still on the floor. We all have to return occasionally to clean up a little more. But I agree, it's time to move along. Tell me, what is your favorite song? The cat then changes into a pied piper with the head of a viper. So follow me. I think you will like what you see. And you think to yourself, this creature is rather perverse. Coming, your answer is terse. So you think me gross. Remember, I am your host. I bid you take care. I warn you only once, for I am fair. Then you sheepishly follow behind, keeping his words in the forefront of your mind. You enter a garden, thinking you should ask for the Pied Piper's pardon. You begin to speak as he hands you your treat, a nice red apple. With this you really don't want to grapple. But take it, you know you must, for after its knowledge you lust. The Pied Piper laughs aloud. Of himself he feels quite proud. Go on, he teases. Me this pleases. He continues to mock. This something in you it unlocks. Throwing the apple, you hit him in his third eye. You're a fool, he cries. Into a rage he goes. Vileness out of him flows. You leave him throwing a bloody tantrum and decide to look around some. You come upon an angel in white. Overcome are you by this fantastic sight. Up to it directly you walk. Sit down, it bid you. Let's talk. Looking at apples, I see. At least you didn't remove it from the tree. And I noticed the apple you didn't bite. In this, you were quite right. It wasn't necessary, you realize. The Pied Piper was telling you lies. I know you state, but where does that leave me? The possessor of wisdom, you see. For in this quest, you did not sell your soul. You remained in control. You let your higher self lead the way, and so on the path you stay. Then walked up the Pied Piper, still with the head of a viper. Clasping hands with the angel, they walk away. Turning, they state in harmony, proceed, you may. You watch them in a daze, as they drift off into a haze. Shaking your head, you turn to go, moving through the garden rather slow. You sit down upon a rock. Of these things, you must take stock. So how goes it? Asks the cat as it walks up to you and sits. You look tired. How about a jump from the pan into the fire? Sighing, you say you might as well. I knew you would. I could tell. Just walk up those stairs. Keep your eyes open for snares. Up the steps you shuffle. Seems it'll take a lot to get you ruffled. Till to the top you get, and by a blank vista you are met. You turn to go back down, but there is nothing anywhere around. And you notice you're standing on a cloud, immaculately clothed in a shroud. Well, what to do, you think? To what must I link? Grabbing on to a passing star, you decide to ride it, not too far. This way to heaven, a signpost reads, the sign you decide to heed. Going forward, a large statue you see. Getting closer, you exclaim, hey, that's me. Entering into the heart gives you quite a start. Next into the head, you are led. You exit through the top, and there you don't stop. You climb a silver cord, moving along, never bored. You arrive in another dimension. Never this did the cat mention. And suddenly you become scared. For this you are not prepared. You begin to tremble. Your old self you again resemble. And you sense yourself falling, for help all the time calling. And warmth you feel. Your head it reels. You are so tired, finding yourself staring into a fire. And you think, what a strange dream, wondering what did it all mean. You feel a little empty inside, a feeling you can't hide. The fire's gone out and you're cold. Time to leave, you sense you're being told. Going to the door, you pass a cat on the floor. Outside, you take one last look back, but you can't see anything. The house has gone black. Shrugging your shoulders, you head down the road, on yourself feeling a bit of a load. With a sensation of being incomplete, you remark again, that house I will meet, at a time when I know why to it I must go.
That's a good poem, that. You know, there's so much in that poem, which is very interesting. Yeah, I was making some notes there as you were speaking so that I could annoy you with clever questions. which, and you know, it's not just clever questions or whatever. It's really because, you know, like part of my journey has been trying to figure out what all this stuff means. And I think other people are trying to figure out the same thing, too. And you've brought up a bunch of stuff there, which seems interesting. And the first thing, which there was a bunch of stuff which seemed interesting, but the first one was when you were in the poem, you go into a room and Freud's there with a sack, and there is something there, which there's the discovery of the sexual self. And you know, this seems like I've got a feeling this is a big deal, at least when people are beginning. Probably it may always be a big deal, I'm not sure, but like when I started manifesting demonic figures, they seemed to be sexually related. They seem to be sort of menacing me. And I wonder, what do you think the role of sexuality plays in the entrance into these mystical worlds. Is that like a door which has to be broken down and deconstructed in order to fully enter into the shamanic world?
I think it's more, you know, the breaking down and the forcing of something. I think it's more of realizing your wholeness as a human being and the different aspects of yourself, and not the separation of, oh, this part of me, that part of me, and then the unconscious and this and that, but rather to be able to unify yourself as a whole holistic being that you are. And that realizing that, you know, the sexual part of us is part of nature, it's part of creation, but that energy can also be can be used and can be controlled to energize again the rest of your chakra system, the rest of your being, you know, how you use your energies in your life and how you expend them and how you again respect them. Myself, I, as one other poem I it's in there, I chose to use this, you know, sexual energy to fill my spiritual cup and to energize that portion of me. And but that's not to negate other people who want to have, you know, family lives and children and to experience, you know, beautiful sexuality. But I would say they're separate. There's something when you're doing ayahuasca or you're doing any kind of ceremony or you're working with teacher plants, that you don't mix those two energies, because they're powerful and they can create problems. And that's why in the training that I had in my cannabis ceremonies, I say on the day of ceremony, there's no sexuality of any sort, including self-pleasuring.
Sure.
Because it's just such a powerful energy source. But mystics through the ages have used to channel that energy, again, to work into the mystical. But that's not, again, I don't want people to get the idea that I'm putting down anything, but I think it has to, that energy should be respected as any other energy and any other, you know, medicine, and not to abuse it.
Yeah. A quick question. Like, in our world today, sexuality is pretty crazy. I mean, like, apparently half of the funding for the internet comes from pornography, and some people might argue that's, some people might say, well, it's the opening up of sexuality, people are finally being open. On the other hand, some people are saying, well, it's actually the twisting of sexuality. For example, the other day my daughter, who's 8 years old, was trying to look up, she was interested in finding skeletons of bears to try and understand their structure. And so in Spanish, she looked up osos maduros, or old bears. Now, this is a euphemism, apparently, for hairy gay men. And so what happened is, instead of finding skeletons of bears...
Oh, my goodness.
It was, she got this uncensored image stream of gay men going at it. Now, there's part of that which is like, okay, great, these guys are getting to express themselves. That's wonderful. Then on the other hand, there's like, oh, my God, my daughter is scarred for life. But I guess
intense, yeah.
My question is like, when we're dealing with these sexual energies, and like, is there, I know, like, I know that what you're saying, and a lot of people say this, is like, ultimately we're all one and everything's a reflection of love. Totally agree. But on a practical level, on a day-to-day basis, we do seem to bump into these like negative, perceivably negative things or positive things. And does that, like, I mean, that happened to me, you know, like, I had these sex demonesses coming out trying to tempt me into lust. And it was funny because in your poem, I was interested because you talk about at the end there, I think the cat says to you, well, you've passed the test, you didn't sell your soul, you didn't cave in to temptation. And I'm interested. And also, you also mentioned something about snares. There are snares which are there to trap you. And I'm interested what your perception is about what is temptation, who's laying these snares, and why are we being tempted? Why are we being tricked into trying to not see our true selves? Because that's what it seems like it's like, maybe, you know?
Well, it's interesting. We play such games with ourselves, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I would say, we're getting back to the before we got here, is there's this a thing about you know, this respect and the respect of people's space, and to, you know, it's fine what your trip is, but you shouldn't inflict it on to others that may not be receptive to that. Like on Facebook the other day, it was really strange. Somebody sent me a message with a lot of these pornographic pictures, and I was going, well, that's like really weird. Where did that come from?
Right.
But of course, I blocked the person and deleted it. But I mean, who gives a person a right to do that to another person without their saying it's okay? And so it comes down to respect, and respect of another being, and respect of yourself. And that seems to be lacking, I would say, in our current world. You know, and what people do in the privacy of their own lives is their business, but I would say they have no right to push that on somebody else if they're if it's not a trip. And so the internet is a wonderful tool for us being able to meet and talk happened through the internet. Otherwise, but it's also become very abused. And you know, where's that balance again between, you know, freedom and protection? And that's being, you know, discussed and thought about all the time. And
I'm actually more interested in like the personal struggle. Obviously, like in the social sphere, there's obviously this struggle with the limitations of our personal expression. But in the personal sphere, in your poem, you're talking about snares and temptation, and those aren't social things. Those are we talking about games we're playing with ourselves? Is that what it is?
Well, and then because any journey it's not a smooth journey. I mean, you run across these things to test your sincerity, what you know and what your intent is and how decided are you. And as you go through the cleansing of yourself and the rebuilding of yourself and unifying yourself, you release things, and these tests are part of your sincerity and understanding of the world, and as you expand your consciousness and you understand more, you see things in more perspective. And so, of course, the temptations and things like that, they're distractions. What will easily pull you off your course of what you say, what your decision and your intent is? You know, how really strong and how sincere are you on what you're doing? And every test and every little block you overcome, it's a teaching. It's a teaching step.
Yeah.
And do you learn it? And so those are the words I use are metaphors, because I think people can relate to that in their lives. And I've had several people that have written the book saying they read it actually several times. And every time they read it, they understand more, because life is cyclical, right?
Yeah.
And but it's more of a corkscrew. As we corkscrew spiral through space and time, we come around again, perhaps to something that seems like it's a similar event that, God, didn't we already do this? But when you come around, you've grown in your understanding. Your consciousness has expanded. And so every experience is different and new in how you handle it and how you grow from that. So it's never ever the same. But in order to grow, you know, you experience these things and how you handle them. And I'm not doing any kind of judgment or comparison, because everybody is on their own individual trip, and we have to respect that and give everyone compassion, knowing that they're on they're growing at their own rate and their own trip. But we all go through things, and we all learn from them, and that learning is part of full self-realization.
Yeah.
So I'm not saying using those words as a negativity, but it's part of the process of becoming a fully aware being.
You also mentioned something it's just a quick phrase, but I noticed it in your poem about a silver cord. Now, a lot of people might recognize the idea of a silver cord from astral projections and other kinds of magical journeys which people can make. And it made me wonder, because, you know, one of the problems I had was around the time I started having issues was I had decided, you know, like, for me, my journey was with ayahuasca, although I did a lot of cannabis. My shaman was also a cannabis shaman, and we did a lot of cannabis. but But, you know, one of the things that happened is I was trying to understand, you know, because, like, I was, before I started in this journey, I had no idea what I was getting myself into. And, you know, as it was revealing itself to me, like, I started thinking, well, this is like magic. There's something magical going on here. And so I thought, you know, I've got to understand what that is. So I started, like, getting every book I could find about magic, whether it was, like, Western tradition magic, whether it was, like, Tibetan Buddhism, whatever it was, just trying to find out what the hell was going on. I'm interested, have you explored those other forms which are done typically without medicine? You know, because a lot of these types, gurus or whatever they might be, seem to be able to connect to, like, head spirits, probably not related to plants, I guess. But do you think is that something which is wise to do? Is it stupid to try and mix traditions? Is it stupid to try and, like, learn? Because I got to the feeling like, wow, maybe this is really stupid trying to learn two things at once because I've opened too many portals, you know? I it was like I knew too much information. And maybe that's dangerous. What's your opinion on that?
Myself, I don't work with magics because magics are basically works in illusion, and they're not real. They don't have real substance in the end. And I definitely, I would never have mixed it with my work with ayahuasca or cannabis, and I don't deal with that, those forms. And I would say if you don't know what you're doing, you could run into a lot of problems, for sure.
Yeah, oh no, for real.
I personally don't recommend it. I'm not, you know, putting anybody down for studying it, but it's not my path.
Sure. Yeah, no, I was really just curious. I wasn't actually practicing it. I was just trying to figure out what the hell is going on, you know, to try and give me, like, a broader perspective. But it seems like even just...
Go ahead.
You go.
If you want to understand, you have to learn to quiet the mind.
Yeah.
You have to be able to learn to focus and center and just to quiet. That's why the one Ikaro I sang with Papatua, he was talking about straightening your energy, straightening your mind, your heart, and all the energies in your body. Tranquil mind, no turbulence. And that's really important. It's just, and how you do that is just focus. Because what you focus on is what you experience. So you just focus, and over time you learn to gently let your mind drop down into your heart center, and that you work through your heart center, and that what you see, and the heart center is the center of medicine and of love, of oneness, of wholeness, and you learn to see with your third eye. You see through your heart, through your mind. You think through your heart, and so you're always thinking through medicine, and you're always seeing through medicine. Yeah. And so that's my guide. And people
yet,
will say, well,
and yet,
do that. Go ahead.
And yet, you know, during our conversation, at one point you were talking about the chakras, you know, and how it's good to have, like, aligned chakras. And you started the conversation using, like, the Tibetan, the ringing bells. But, you know, our chakras, is that like a traditional, do shamans in the Amazon talk about chakras, or is that, I'm wondering if you're actually are you actually mixing things a little bit yourself, maybe a little bit of Tibetan stuff, a little bit of chakras, I don't know, I'm just asking.
No, because I'm not using Tibetan stuff, I'm using the medicine bowl and the Buddha medicine, but one of the Ikaros I learned is known as Arco Iris.
Yeah.
Arco iris, rainbow, rainbow medicine, seven colors of divine white light, seven colors of divine white light, teach us divine wisdom, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red, arco iris. that's a traditional ayahuasca. So shamans work with the spirit world, and the rainbow is, and color medicine is an extremely powerful medicine. When you work with different plant teachers, well, a lot of people, when I worked with Sanango and I dieted Sanango, the color, the purple was, and the violet colors were intense. And because, again, you're working with that plant, and it's medicine, and a lot of, they have color, and so that's not mixing tradition at all. I may use different instruments, but I don't consider that mixing anything. It's
I wasn't trying to challenge you at all. I was just trying to get a better understanding, you know. It's interesting, but it is interesting too that, you know, that there are seven colors in the rainbow, and like there's seven chakras which have colors, so maybe there's like an informal, you know, because one of the things is I've been doing all my reading. Like, a lot of, like, traditions are completely unrelated, like shamanism and Buddhism and Western magic. But weirdly, there are some correlations between some of the ideas, you know? So it's kind of interesting. Well,
and what's interesting also is about the chakras is that there aren't just seven. When you go down to Mother Earth, there's more going down. And when you go out the crown of your chakra, there's, you know, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, infinitely, your sun. So it's just, you know, where you are. And that's what I meant by the silver cord, mainly, is you're moving along that, you know, dimensional cord to infinity. But so, of course, there's going to be similarities between knowledge systems, because universally, they're universal medicines. It's universal knowledge. I mean, right. There's going to be correlations between them.
Yeah, I guess it's just the interpretations from the different perspectives of different people. Now we're running a bit late, Victoria. But I'm just interested. You've done this book. It's really great. People should buy it. I'll put the link on there for Amazon. Now, you do work as a master shaman. You're based in, where are you based? Because people might want to contact you. They're listening to your Icaros, thinking, wow, she seems really authentic. How can I work with Victoria Carella?
I'm in the state of Arizona in the United States.
Yeah.
That's where my practice is. And I don't know if I mentioned, but I only practice in states, in the United States, where, well, anywhere, where medical and or recreational cannabis is legal.
Sure.
And if you said, you mentioned you can put up my Facebook page, and
sure,
people can get the message, but I would ask them to preface their message, because if we're not friends, it gets sent to the, you know, filtered box, and they should say in there, I heard you on Scott's talk, and I'd like to talk more with you, just so I know. I just don't delete them, as some, you know, sometimes I get strange messages from people. And so I would say forward it like that, and they could also go to my page and just look through it, and I'd love to hear from anybody, and I do hope they at least take a chance to go on Amazon and read some of the reviews and see how this book is affecting different people, and I'd love to get feedback on it from people if they do buy it and read it, how they feel about it.
You had a lot of good reviews. And I found reading it that what really came out was ironically, it's called Journeys. It was the journey. Like, reading through it, just allowing yourself to getting into the moment and following your journey. It became quite interesting once you got into the style. It was really interesting, and also quite personal about how you express some of these things that happened to you.
Yeah, and it's what's really. What's neat to me is it came out in poetry. When I sat down to write, it came out in poetry, which to me is like really cool. It's like a lost art sometimes. And the book itself has allowed me to share the medicine on a much larger platform, and it's allowed me to reach more people. And for that, I'm really grateful, you know, and like it's allowing us to have this talk right now, which is really nice.
No, I'm really glad we did it. You know, it was a good chat we've had. I always feel good after I've learned something. And had a good vibrational moment with somebody new, you know, it was cool. So I'm really happy you came on. I'll try and get this published in the next couple of days. And thanks so much, Victoria. Yeah. we'll wrap it up for just now. And maybe, you know, depending on, you know, a couple of, several times, I often have people on more than once, you know.
I'd love that. That would be really cool if you like.
Because, you know, you've got a lot of interesting perspectives. And, like, I've had a lot of personal issues. And the funny thing is that when I created my Facebook group, Ayahuasca Magic, a lot of people came on there because they also had problems, you know, just like integrating and this kind of thing. Yes. So it's always good to hear from somebody who's a master shaman, who's got like a more mature perspective to give some guidance, you know, to help people out, you know.
That's why I'm here.
Yeah, right? Excellent. Okay, Victoria, thanks very much for coming on, yeah? And we'll talk to you soon, yeah?
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.